Hi, hope you're all doing great. I hope you all had a wonderful 2019. Wish you all a happy new year 2020. And I'm equally sure that you're going to have an amazing and an eventful 2020. By the way, let's not just hope for such a year to happen, rather let's make it happen. So loads of love from me and from Toffee as well. Take care. Hi, so let's start with today's discussion with focus on the following topics, starting with delta clasp. So as you can see, this is a delta clasp. It's derived from Adam's clasp and its name comes from the shape of its return to portion as evident. It's commonly used in twin block appliance because with this appliance, occlusal interferences are not an issue and an extremely return to clasp is needed. Like the Adam's clasp, the tooth to be clasped must be erupted enough to expose the buccal undercuts. Right? Now, moving on to the next topic, intentional relief pertaining to removable partial denture. Here is some literature. So the border of the major connector should be 6 mm away from the gingival margins in the maxillary arch in order to avoid any injury to the highly vascular marginal gingiva as evident in this illustration. Right? Moving on to the next topic, cleft lip repair timing, which we discussed in one of the revision classes before the exam. Here is some literature for you. Although not absolute, a general and easy rule for timing of cleft lip repair is a rule of 10s, which was given by Williamson and Musgrave way back in 1969, where the child should be at least of 10 weeks of age, weigh at least 10 pounds and should have at least 10 grams per deciliter of hemoglobin. Right? Moving on to the next question, various clinical tests to assess mouth breathing, mirror test, butterfly test is one among such tests. So as you can see in the literature, it's important to fully diagnose a patient with habit of mouth breathing through various clinical tests available. The mirror test and water retention test are among the breathing tests most cited in literature. The lip seal test was the most frequently used, followed by mirror test and water retention test. The mirror test is also called as fog test. A double-sided mirror is held between the nose and the mouth. Fogging on the nasal side of the mirror indicates nasal breathing, while fogging on the oral side indicates mouth breathing. Maslow's water holding test, that is, patient is asked to hold the mouth full of water and we perform the test as evident in the image. Maslow and Zwemer butterfly test or cotton test, where a butterfly shaped cotton strands are placed over the upper lip below nostrils. On exhalation, if the fibers flutter downwards, the patient is a nasal breather, and if the fibers flutter upwards, the patient is a mouth breather. Right? Now let's move on to the next question pertaining to heart muscle. I'll present you with some literature, see if it is helpful in answering your question. Pertaining to cauda tendon and also crista supraventricularis, here is some information and literature. So each ventricle contains cone-shaped muscular pillars called papillary muscles, that is nipples. These muscles are attached to cusps of atrioventricular valves by thin, strong connective tissue strings called caudae tendinae. The papillary muscles contract when the ventricles contract and prevent the valves from opening into the atria by pulling on the caudae tendinae attached to the valve cusps. Blood flowing from the atrium into the ventricle pushes the valve open into the ventricle. However, when the ventricle contracts, blood pushes the valve back towards the atrium. The atrioventricular canal is closed as valve cusps meet, which is very, very important, and it's clearly evident in the illustration. There is caudae tendinae. And coming to crista supraventricularis. So during careful studies of human cardiac conduction system, the anatomy of crista supraventricularis is an inescapable concomitant demonstration. The crista supraventricularis is similar in human and canine hearts. Right? In addition to dividing the inflow and outflow pathways of right ventricle, the crista supraventricularis is crucially located to join interventricular septum and left ventricle to much of the right ventricular free wall, thereby playing an important role in emptying the right ventricle and closing the tricuspid valve. Right, so this is some information pertaining to these valves. See if it is helpful in answering your question. If you need any additional information, do let me know. Various radiopaque structures, You can find the same in White and Farrow, and also we discussed prior in our e-classes and study club discussions. Following is a list of most radiolucent to most radio-opaque materials seen in plane radiographs, starting with the most radiolucent, that is air, fat, gas, followed by fluid, followed by soft tissue, followed by bone marrow, followed by trabecular bone, followed by cortical bone and dentin, followed by enamel, and then metal, which is the most radio-opaque structure. Now, moving on to the next question, xylolith management. So we have different management strategies as evident in the literature. So small stones often may be milked out through the duct orifice by bimanual palpation. If the stone is too large or located in the proximal duct, non-surgical or minimally invasive xylolithotomy using intracorporeal lithotripters has become a popular treatment modality in Europe. The US FDA has not approved extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy for treatment of xyloliths in US. Xyloadenoscopes with varying grasping forceps and baskets have been developed for extraction of stones from salivary gland ducts using ductoplasty and in some cases preventing the removal of submandibular gland. In cases of exceedingly large or intraparenchymal xyloliths, surgical removal of stone or gland may be required. Now moving on to the next question, heterophile antibody. Here is some information pertaining to the same. So as you can see, in case of infectious mononucleosis, agglutination of horse RBCs on exposure to EB virus, that is heterophile antibodies, is a highly specific test. We call this as monospot test. Also, the information which is mentioned now is from Schaeffer's. Now let's review some information given in Harsh Mohan. Test for heterophile antibodies. Heterophile antibody test, that is Paul Bunnell test, is used for making the diagnosis of infectious mononucleosis. In this test, patient's serum is absorbed with guinea pig kidney. Serum dilutions are prepared, which are used for agglutination of red cells of sheep, horse, or cow, and are reported as heterophile titer of test serum. A high serum titer of 40 or more times is diagnostic of acute infectious mononucleosis infection in symptomatic case in the first week. Heterophile antibodies peak during third week in 80-90% of the cases, and the test remains positive for about 3 months after the illness started. The test has to be repeatedly performed, and similar antibody is also produced in patients suffering from serum sickness and has to be distinguished by differential absorption studies. Heterophile antibodies are not demonstrable in children under 5 years of age or in quite elderly. Consider this very important. Currently, more sensitive and rapid kit-based test for heterophile antibodies, that is monospot, is also available. So here is some information for you. See if it is helpful in reviewing your question. Moving on to the next topic, superficial temporal artery. So where do you palpate? So let's review some literature pertaining to the same. The superficial temporal artery, as you can see in the image, passes superficial to posterior root of zygomatic arch, just anterior to the tragus. Gentle palpation of this area often reveals the presence of a pulse, which is frequently more prominent during a migraine attack. Applying distal pressure over the zygomatic arch, thereby compressing the artery against the arch, temporarily occludes the artery. Right, so that's the anatomical location for feeling the pulse related to superficial temporal artery. Right, moving on to the final topic, fontanelle anatomy based question. So as you can see, we have anterior as well as posterior fontanelle in this image. So anterior fontanelle is present between the sagittal suture and the coronal suture, and posterior fontanelle is present between the lambdoid suture and the sagittal suture. Right, so these are some of the topics which I wanted to highlight in this specific video. Do let me know if you need any additional information. We'll update them in the description part accordingly. So wish you all a great year. Love you all.